Hello and welcome to Ask VR. The film we're going to discuss today is Bhagyaraj's Dhavani Kanavugal. Actually, the questions that you guys sent were quite phenomenal. Some of them really, really made me think. So, I think the older we go, I think the better questions we seem to get. So let's take a look, begin with Kabilan, who wants to know, Bhagyaraj is famous for creating his own way in the industry and he assisted Baradwaj. What do you think of his resemblance to his master's works? Is there any format he has adapted from Baradwaj that we fail to notice? See, if there's a format at all, I think it's the fact that, they were kind of, they did a number of types of films. Let me explain. See, when we think of Baradwaj, we think of the rural drama, right? But then, he's made suspense thrillers like Tick, Tick, Tick and Sigur Projakal. He's made social dramas like Vedam Pudidu and Pudumai Pen. He's made mood pieces like Niralgal. He's made love stories like Kadalovyam, Alaygaloi Vidillai, like a whole bunch of them. But yet, we keep talking as though Baradwaj made only Padanaru Vaidhinle and Manvasane and things like that. So that branding is actually something that even Bhagyaraj kind of got associated with, because, he's made suspense thrillers like Vidiyum Varai Kathiru. He's made, like social dramas like, Orukai Osei and, Suvarilada Chitrangal was a very tragic kind of Bhagyaraj movie. And yet, we keep talking about Bhagyaraj as a light-hearted kind of person. So, What has he learned from his master? It's very hard to say, because the closest overlap to their films comes only in the social drama kind of thing. But I think it's more of the fact that they probably were instrumental in taking Tamil cinema away from the melodrama that they inherited from the previous year. So for instance, if you notice, in the 70s is when, Tamil cinema started getting like non-melodramatic, right? Because people like, Baradwaj and even Balachandar's work became more cinematic and less theatrical. So Mahendran was there, Balu Mahendra was there. So I think Bhagyaraj kind of inherited a bit of that legacy as well and then took it forward in his own unique comic style. So that's what he was doing. Rajeshwar wants to know, any particular reason to choose this rather than Indrupo Nalaiva? And I'm thinking, Raghu asks, I'm thinking how you make the selection of movies, any criteria? We just want interesting films to talk about, that's one thing. But to go back to that question about why this rather than Indrupo Nalaiva, it's because Indrupo Nalaiva is what you typically think of as a Bhagyaraj film. It's a funny film, right? But actually his work, so to speak, over his career, that's actually a bit of an exception. That kind of pure comedy is a bit of an exception, because you find more of the socially oriented drama but filled with comedy is what he's been making over and over and over. So I thought that would be interesting to kind of get into this. Dhavani Kanavugal was the first film that Bhagyaraj produced, and if you look at the logo, you'll kind of see where the space that he was in. Anand Sethuraman has a fun question. Is it the first Tamil movie that shows premarital sex on screen? And of course, you had to come up with this question because we're talking about Bhagyaraj. But no, actually, this was a movie in 1984. And if you look earlier in 1984, this movie Vidhi came out and that showed premarital sex. And of course, there are other films as well. I was kind of waiting for this question to come up and it did. Surya Prakash asks, Dhavani Kanavugal has a unique treatment other than that of other Bhagyaraj films. How do you rate this screenplay against his other successful films like Mundane Mudiche, Thural Inna Poochu, Idanamalu? How is it different from other rags to riches story? Actually, this is not the best of his screenplays, in my opinion, because, there's a, like, as other commenters have noted down below, it has a fairly, like, realistic as in within quotes first half, but the second half turns very artificial, and the rags to riches part is actually like, it's almost like it's two separate movies, the rags part and the riches part. And I find the Ithural Hindu Poetry kind of screenplay much more organic than what this is. Bravo Man asked, did Bhagyaraj get inspired from the interview scenes of Varumeniram Sivappu and Thillumullu, mixing them both here? He's talking about this interview scene. I don't know if he was inspired, but you can kind of, I think it was also the time then when almost all the Tamil movies of that era were kind of, that was kind of what was on people's minds, you know, the Vela Ila Patadari, which Dhanush is doing now, that was actually a reality then. And like, you know, had several films about people who were graduates but did not have jobs. That was a constant refrain in many, many films. So, that's probably more like it. Arun says, things that work for me, Radhika and Bhagyaraj scenes, even though they are away from the core plot, they are. And one of the Shivaji movies I liked him for his national performance. Your comment and work, what works for you? My comment is, I don't think this is a particularly natural performance of Shivaji's, and Radhika and Bhagyaraj scenes, they are away from the core plot, and Radhika is always nice to watch because she has wonderful energy on screen. But you know that by the time she comes into the movie, which is like part of, bit of the second half, the movie is kind of beginning to drift away. But I'll tell you what works for me, right? These older films, I love to see. That not just the Madras that they depict, but also the India that they depict. Like, I'll give you some examples here. So this kind of, you know, what the population of India being so much and the cost of hiding, it's a bit of a blast of nostalgia, what once was. So I think, you know, more than, you know, I think those kinds of things are also worthwhile in a movie when you watch it today. Sats Vijay says, Bhagyaraj sir easily became star in a film that was not realistic. Actually, I don't hold not being realistic as a major problem in a movie because, you know, very few of our films are realistic in the real sense. But Bhagyaraj was a star because at this point, he, Mundane Murchi had become a blockbuster. He was, you know, being talked about in the same breath as Kamalhasan and Rajinikanth and all those people. So, yes, he was a very big star at that point. Now we get to the film's most legendary scene. Sarita Rao says, haha, that movie theatre scene is priceless. Ishwaran says, according to you, what makes that coin drop scene in the theatre so famous and still very memorable? Even today we have a lot of references and YouTube videos whenever they're talking about intimate scenes on screen. So the movie theatre scene, it's very funny, right? Because he's dropping a coin every time, you know, there's an intimate scene, and or rather every time the scene gets a little adult and, you know, he doesn't want his sisters to watch. But more importantly, you have the positioning of the scene in the screenplay, what makes it stand out. Because just before then, one of his sisters has, one Punnupakra scene has happened, and the Mapala Bhagyaraj discovers cannot speak, so he's woman. So the thing is, they're in such a dire condition that the mother, without telling Bhagyaraj, has called this speech, this person who cannot speak. And the girl can get married kind of thing is what's happening. And that scene ends badly, and the prospective groom is sent away. And so the general mood is very, very sad. And then Shivaji suggests, why don't you all just cheer up a bit, and, you know, why don't you go watch a movie? So it's not just Bhagyaraj and his family that are being cheered up, it's the audience also that's being cheered up, because we've just had a very sad and melodramatic scene, and now this scene comes later, so it just kind of stands out because of where it's been positioned in the screenplay. So Bhagyaraj, I think that way he was very, very, you know, clever about what he wanted to do. He kind of keep changing moods throughout the screenplay and kind of, you know, make sure that, you know, we were kind of led through the whole thing in a nice way. Srini says, I often hear Bhagyaraj being referred to as a master of screenplay writing. Can you take a scene from this movie that you think is proof of this mastery and describe the nuances that you see? I just told you about that coin toss scene, right? That's there. And then Harish Jayesh asks, I want to ask you about the famed Bhagyaraj screenplay in this movie and what you think of it from a pacing, lucidity and intelligence perspective. It is often mentioned that Bhagyaraj was the master of moving his stories, which were not always unique, at a brisk pace, as though crisp scenes that were not very redundant. Your thoughts? And then there's another question along these lines. Sai Vicky says, the writing still fascinates me. For example, how the tailor and the laundry guy and the postman characters are introduced with a sympathy towards Bhagyaraj's family. Later, they come together in a way that brings a closure to the story, which attaches itself to the standard feel-good masala template. My question is this. Do you think Bhagyaraj's key success as a hero came because of his writing, or his willingness to make himself the object of most of the jokes? So let me contrast what Bhagyaraj is doing in this film with a film that came around the same time, which is Balachandra's Kalyana Gadigal, right? So, or even Varumendanam Sivappu that came a little earlier. So we're talking about a lot of filmmakers who are dealing with the same kind of themes of unemployment, large families, dowry and all these things. So, but you know, what Bhagyaraj does is, what Balachandra's treatment is relatively realistic to kind of thing. He kind of sticks to the core issues. Of course, there'll be a bit of romance or something, and there'll be a bit of something else. But the core issue is never, the tone of the movie is more or less is kept to. Whereas with Bhagyaraj, you'll find random action sequences, for instance. You know, he was a big fan of MGR, and he used to show all his films to MGR. And MGR once told him that, you know, he said he have a fight scene in all his films, because he said the masses would understand only if there is a scene where the good guy beats up the bad guy. So, you know, that kind of, you know, thing that did not really belong in a social drama, that Bhagyaraj would have. And then he'd have dream duets. And then he'd have a message also at the end. So with all of this, he was taking that drama that was there earlier and making it in his own way, which I think gave what maybe you'd call a little bit for everybody, because a Balachandra drama would probably appeal to only somebody who was in that frame of mind. Whereas here you have a, you know, you're making a masala out of it. You have a fight, you have a song, you have something else, like a dream duet, not just a song. So all of that, and then you had the comedy, like you know, if you look at the scene where Bhagyaraj kind of chases away the guys who are, you know, Eve teasing his sisters, that's a classic example of a serious issue being addressed in a very, very light way. So that's what really made him stand out at the time. Rakesh asks, when the hero should have been burning up the disco floor for the ditty Oru Nayagan Udayamagiran, Bhagyaraj with his two left feet and zero wattage deflates the energy in the air. Should he have stuck to direction and screenplay writing, Bharati Raja? But if he had stuck to that, would we get this moment today and enjoy it as much today? Tell me. Anand Sethuraman asks, Dhavani Kanavugal brings forth the often discussed topic Sivaji Ganesan doing overacting basically, especially his admiration to Subhash Chandra Bose on his deathbed. However, in spite of this film and films like Mridanga Chakravarti, Vietnam Veedu, Gauravam, etc., I feel he was aware of it and did it purposefully to endear himself to the masses. Would love to hear your thoughts on this. So the Netaji scene is there, right? See, I think there are many theories here, and a lot of people have talked about how Sivaji Ganesan was deliberately, you know, playing to the gallery, because that was what people accepted as good acting at that time. Actually, even today, if you look at it, even Kamal Hassan did the same thing at the end of Papanasam, because he kind of, when Mohanlal underplayed it a bit, Kamal kind of went a little bit, you know, not overboard, but just notch it up a little, because went up a notch, because, you know, that's the audience he's kind of a thing, and he's kind of catering to. And when people kind of don't see a visible acting, right, if somebody behaves like Irfan Khan here, for instance, they might say he didn't do anything at all, he didn't act at all, right? Because people want to see a little acting. I'm not saying this is ideal, but I think there is some wisdom in catering to what the audiences expect of you, especially. And by then you have to understand that Sivaji was also such a huge brand that, you know, that was probably what is expected of him. Do I like it personally? No. But I can understand why he went that way. And I think, you know, he proved with Devar Magan that he could do anything. It's just that I think he was kind of, you know, he wanted to do this. Yogesh Chinadurai says, why Rajini or Kamal are not trying to do the kind of role that Sivaji sir did? Do you think this generation of superstars are running behind stardom? I think that that till somebody is accepted as a hero, there is no tradition of people graduating to a supporting character or an elder kind of role in Tamil cinema. So as long as Rajinikanth and Kamal Haasan are still being accepted as a hero, they're probably going to just be the hero. But you do find a movie like, in a movie like Indian, you will find Kamal acting as the older man, but still because he's still the hero of the film, A, and plus there is a younger man also to kind of contrast this, which he has done in many films. So I think that's how it is today. Arun Pradeep has two questions. I thought the great Sivaji Ganesan did his role well, not letting Bhagyaraj poke fun at him almost at will. Considering this is probably the only film in which the two shared space, what other Bhagyaraj film would you have liked to see Sivaji in, and what role? I'm thinking of the role that Kallapetti Singaram played in Darling, 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 which is Bhagyaraj's father. He pretends to be the owner of the bungalow and is actually kind of just the caretaker.
எப்படி ஒரு செட்டப்பா உட்கார்ந்திருக்காங்க பாத்தியா? அவங்கள பார்த்தா யாராவது பங்களா வாட்சிமேன்னு தமிழ்காரின்னு சொல்ல முடியுமா? அவன் கொடுத்து வச்சவன்.
And I think a comic role like that would have been kind of right up Shivaji's alley, because one of the tragedies of Sivaji Ganesan's career is that despite him being a very good comedian, he didn't get enough comic roles. And I think like pure comic roles. And I think this might have been a good opportunity, though the role is short. But it, had the role been expanded, it might have been a fun thing to see Sivaji Ganesan in. And this is actually a fantastic question, actually. What was the 80s, the golden age of actors who scripted and made their own movies? You had Kamal Haasan, Bhagyaraj, T. Rajendra, Visu, Pandirajan, etc. Who did this? So they acted and wrote or directed it, other things. But in this generation, very few seem to be attempting it. Why do you think this is so? You know, this question really stumps me, because it's a really interesting question. Earlier, you did not find MGR, Shivaji, Jay Shankar, Muthuraman, all those people. They were just actors, right? They kind of came, did the role and went away. The script was somebody else's, the director was somebody else. But in the 80s, you start finding actors, the people that are writing are also being, coming on screen. And I think maybe Bhagyaraj is the pioneer simply because, maybe by accident, right? I'm pretty sure. I'm sorry, I'm not sure, but what I'm trying to say is, see, Baradwaj was looking for a hero for Pudhiya Varpugal because Kamal Haasan was busy and did not have the dates. Now, till the last minute, he did not get a leading man, and then he cast Bhagyaraj, who was his assistant, simply because, let's just see what happens kind of thing, and they were so close that they needed a leading man. And that became such a blockbuster that suddenly this kind of leading man was accepted. So then when Bhagyaraj started actually, so far he was assisting Baradwaja. Then when Bhagyaraj actually started making his own movies, he thought, I've already acted in a blockbuster, why not, play the hero myself, right? I don't know whether he had the ambition of becoming the leading man earlier, but definitely I'm sure Pudhiya Varpugal kind of made him reconsider that whole thing. And once others saw that Bhagyaraj was being accepted as a hero and he was also writing another kind of thing, I think that kind of set the trend of people doing this. Otherwise, it's not possible. It's a little difficult to imagine Pandirajan and all these other people doing similar things. In this generation, very few people seem to attempt it. I don't know why, because first of all, maybe there's just not enough talent, because you do find like someone like Siddharth doing it. He co-wrote Aval, he writes some stuff, but I don't know why there aren't enough people doing it. But yes, that was definitely a golden age, so to speak, for actors who also did this, and that was really a good question. I kind of enjoyed thinking about it. And also, I think, in those days, people, were doing a kind of a domestic drama more often than they are today. So all these actors kind of fit in there, and they did not need a special hero in order to play the lead in these movies. Whereas in today, the roles being written need a kind of mythic hero to be the leading man. And I think very few people fit that bill, and these people certainly don't. Maybe that's another reason. Original Venkatesh asks, where does the early Bhagyaraj fit in the rubric of heroes? Is it fair to compare him to, say, Amol Palekar? I think, yeah, when you're talking about the guy next door, maybe you can kind of say it's an Amol Palekar archetype or type. But what really set Bhagyaraj apart from an Amol Palekar is the, you know, the there is an, a strong element of what you'd call maybe self-pity, because he'd like to kind of, he would have these scenes where others spoke badly of him, and then he'd counter it with a scene where he proves why he did something like this. Like in Darling, 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 there's a scene where, you know, he doesn't, you know, he Purnima Jairam thinks that he has money in his pocket, and when her fiancé asks for money, he Bhagyaraj doesn't give it, and she's angry. But then later, so she kind of calls him all kinds of names, but later Bhagyaraj says he saw a beggar woman and gave her the money, and so she starts reevaluating him. So he kind of did that thing where you know, there was a lot of like sympathy generated for the character, and of course he loved to make fun of himself, which you'll just see in the scene here.
Or alagana valibana edhuka kaidu panninga ondirkinga
police kitta poi sollada man
enna poi pesnaanga
nee alagana valibana.
Ambika Natarajan wants to know, in the 80s when Bhagyaraj announced his name in the middle of the movie with a title card promptly giving credits to himself for direction, screenplay and dialogues, it was a time for whistles. Now it's considered so tacky, but the culture doesn't seem to have died, with most heroes giving themselves prefixes. Your comments, please. I think I don't know if it's tacky, because I kind of, one of the things that I found with Bhagyaraj is that one of the things that I used to look forward in his films was to see where his title would come, his title card would come. And they were in all kinds of places. You know, in Indrupo in Aleva, it comes like a disclaimer. In Darling, Darling, it comes at like around the 15 minute mark. In Thural Indru Pochu, it's about the 10 minute mark. Dhavani Kanavugal, it actually comes in the second half, which is almost like some 2 hours and 5 minutes into the movie is when you get the title card.
Jai Hind.
So he was doing something, at least trying to play around with that format, and for that I think his movies are a little more interesting than the other title cards of the time. Anand Govindarajan says, BR, thank you for picking a Bhagyaraj movie. I think he was naughty and rooted writer of his times. The scene where he takes all his sisters to a theater, the coin scene, it's typical. It's certainly true that most parents and elders would squirm at some of the movie scenes during those times and often find out if the movie is family friendly before buying tickets. But how Bhagyaraj chose to do it has plenty of innocence. Who else do you think had that kind of naughtiness in that 80s and 90s? I think a lot of people had that innocence in the 80s and 90s, but I'm thinking of Pandirajan. Who came after Bhagyaraj, and he particularly had this. I'm thinking of this scene in Anpavam where the man says Seekan Kalambu, and then his wife says Korandika Paal Kudukunanga, so that's why she's getting delayed, and the man says Andha Paala Tha Naa Kudichitene, and then the woman says Adilanga Na Butti Paala Sonna. So the thing is, the whole scene, it's like it's so risque, and you know what they're talking about, but the whole theater is laughing because it's somehow the content is adult, but the you know, the delivery or whatever it is, it just seems to be acceptable. So, you know, I think there are lots of people like that. Ajay Kumar says, TR and Bhagyaraj started the trend of taking many credit roles in movies, actor, director, singer, etc. And it made sense that they worked in many roles, but did they make it a trend? But they did make it a trend to follow. I think this way of work has made a film a director's work and not a team work. How do you see it? No, I think definitely the director is undervalued in Tamil cinema, because what a director does, a lot of things, right? He manages the story, he works with every department to impose his vision on that particular department. But the most important thing he does is he takes a screenplay and then uses the camera to transfer the events written on page to a visual way, which is like the cinematic way. This is not either seen or understood by many people because they don't respond very well to anything that is non-dialogue oriented or non-action oriented. You know, if something is visually told, a lot of people just don't catch it or don't give enough respect to it. So I think, I don't know if you know, even today, I think that's why people like to hoard all the credits to themselves, because if they do a pure director's work, then that's just not enough that's recognized there. So which is probably a reason they kind of, you know, try to get the writing and the directing so that the signature of the film still stays with them. I don't know if that answered the question, but I just wanted to make this point. Anand says, what is your favorite scene? Mine is a shooting sequence where he enacts a sister scene with Radhika. Mine is actually this scene where he comes home late and he has a habit of drinking and his mother won't let him in. And then he says this line, which kind of alludes to their situation and also makes a little joke about it. So this I really like this line a lot. The other thing I feel about Bhagyaraj is his scenes are predictable most of the time, but they're very likable. Indrupo and Aleva is another example. Your views. I don't think he really reinvented the stories as such. He found very interesting ways to tell cliched situations and old stories. So I think that, like, for example, you know, the way he kind of in Darling, 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 he's looking forward to meeting the girl that he knew in school and he's still in love with her. But the thing is, he's not seen her as a grown up. So this is how he imagines the scene. And in Thural Innupochu, when, you know, again with Sulakshana, this thing happens and it's a naughty little moment, but it kind of adds a bit of flavor to what would have otherwise been a very traditional ponnu paakra scene.
Ella nalla irukku ana andha gown keela jatti irundha innum nalla irukku.
And even in Dhavani Kanavugal, when Ilavarsi is his mama ponnu or something like that, and when she says that she cannot, she wants to marry him, but the mama says, "Ni veetoda maapule vandru," and this is what Bhagyaraj says.
Unakku aayiram maapule kedupanga, ana en thangichigalukku enna vitta vera oru annan kedaikka maata. Mannichu.
It's a nicely shaped line, you know. I'm not saying it's great, but, you know, there's an effort to kind of shape the line in a way that gives a dramatic kind of punch to the whole scene. That's the kind of thing that I think stand up, because he takes very typical scenes and then adds his touch to them and makes them stand apart. Anu Warrior says, I thought most of the Bhagyaraj films are extremely regressive in content, even when initially watched them thoughts. Yeah, regressive when you see them from today's viewpoint, because two scenes that are particularly like offensive when you see them today in Dhavani Kanavugal are that Uma Mapala scene where the Mapala is thought to be almost like a defective piece of goods because he cannot speak, and everyone becomes, how can you marry such a guy kind of situation happens, and there is no consideration given for, you know, that kind of a thing. Like, it's almost like if you are poor and if you are, you don't have any money, and if you don't have, enough of a family support or whatever, this is all you can get as a mapla, and that's really offensive when you look at it. And another, you know, scene is when Bhagyaraj kind of gets annoyed with Radhika and he slaps her. And she begins to, like, dream of a dream duet. I'm like, you know, that whole thing of, the guy slaps the woman and she takes it as a sign of love. I mean, again, today nobody wants that. But, you know, these are also a thing of the era. So I think that's what it is. Abhishek Spear says, why is it that comedians lose a sense of quirk after they get old? For example, Vadivelu might speak the same dialogue and he always does in a present film, but it won't really work. With an action hero, romantic star, this is understandable. But why do you think comedians, they dry up the comedian? Why do they dry up? Why do they lose the ability to make us laugh? I think it's also because comedy is the toughest thing to do. You know that old saying, right? Dying is easy, comedy is hard. So especially when somebody is doing their own writing, after about maybe 10 films, the writing becomes predictable and, people start, they move on to the new breed of comedian who comes and makes them laugh. So I think that kind of really what happens with comedy. But still, you know, there's like little bits of visual slapstick in Bhagyaraj's films that are still very interesting to watch today. Like, for example, this, when he comes to Madras and wants to become a hero, he begins to visit studios and gradually he, you know, that doesn't work out. So in a series of shots, you see how he's become, he has less and less money, and this is how, you know, the it's shown visually on screen.
Idiot taxi.
Last set of questions. Flyhead Junior says, the first half of the movie was so real and went cinematic when it reaches the climax. Don't you feel that? Yeah, we talked a bit about this, and I think the first half is relatively, you know, the better half. The second half becomes very unrealistic because, you know, first of all, the whole, you know, rags to riches thing, a zero becomes a hero, that whole thing. And also the way, you know, fights and climaxes and everything kind of comes up. It's like, it's almost like you lose sight of the sisters for a very long time, and then suddenly the movie shifts to being a Bhagyaraj showcase. So I don't know, that whole thing does happen there. There are many other excellent Bhagyaraj's films. I personally feel the second half was not that good. We just talked about that. And the final question is, Naveen Kumaresan says, Mundane Mudichu was far greater. What a trendsetter as a whole. Next Karagatakan, please. Yes, Mundane Mudichu was a trendsetter in a sense, because of, you know, especially the way, you know, I still find it hard to believe that the you know, the sale of Murungaka or Drumstick just shot up after that one movie because of, you know, because it was positioned as an aphrodisiac. But the movie was also like a pinnacle of Bhagyaraj's career, and I don't think any other film that he did kind of measured up to that level in terms of the box office. About Karagatakaran, sure, next time maybe, but we this is more of a show where we talk about new movies, and in the absence of new movies, we talk about older films. But if you would like us to regularly talk about older films, let us know and give us suggestions, and we will make that a regular feature as well. Thank you so much for tuning in. This is the end of Ask BR this week. Do keep watching Film Companion South, and thank you for sending in your questions.